Good evening and welcome to another edition of County Connection. I'm your host for this evening, County Commissioner Kevin Barnhardt. I hope to cover about five subjects tonight. They're all very important and are very critical to the future of our community. And if you'd like to call in and ask a question, number here is 610-378-0426, 610-378-0426. Five subjects I'd like to cover in no particular order, but I will go in order, is courtroom, courthouse, services center security, big issue in the news the last couple of weeks, the future of our local jail, our county jail, the 422 bypass reconstruction project, coming up in the future, but not too quickly, is the census 2020 and what that means to the folks in Berks County. And last but not least, an initiative of the Opioids Coalition, as well as our district attorney and his office, is the Blue Cares program that we're going to be rolling out in the community in a very short order. First and most timely is there has been discussion again about the armed security, or should we not armed security, at the county courthouse and services center. There was an incident a few weeks ago where a fellow who has some mental health issues came to the door at about 7:30 in the morning, and the door opens at 8 o'clock. He was told he wouldn't be able to get in until 8 o'clock, became agitated, and basically broke a front window. He was asked to drop the axe, in which he complied, and then he was asked to put his hands behind his back, which he did, and he was handcuffed, which then started a cavalcade of information about we need armed security, we are living on borrowed time, and things like that. So we have done an exhaustive analysis with a firm about 2 years ago on a lot of security and safety measures needed in county buildings. We're in the process of making those changes, whether it's key card access to certain areas of the building, additional cameras, either monitored or unmonitored cameras, potentially arming our SGI security guards with stun guns or tasers, I should call them. And to me, the most important piece, and I think what's been lost in all of this, is mental health first aid. We actually provide mental health first aid training for all of our corrections officers at the jail. Some of our deputy sheriffs have been trained in mental health first aid. And more importantly, we have to get them all trained, as well as all our SGI security guards, so that they can identify and detect when someone is not acting normal. And I've said this to people many, many times. If most people come to the door at 7:30 and they say, well, gee, you can't come in until 8 o'clock, usually find something else to do for half an hour. You read, you get the paper, you go for a cup of coffee. This fellow had caused a disturbance at the same building about 2 years ago, knocked over some barriers inside the building. So he was dealt with in a similar fashion this time as he was in the past. He sought and was given mental health treatment and evaluation. So we do have many folks in the community who are suffering from mental health issues. We need to completely train top to bottom our first responders, our folks who are out on the street dealing with folks, and really help that. So we're still looking at some alternatives to security measures, some increased security measures, as well as the potential of armed guards or armed deputy sheriffs. Unfortunately, society has gotten a little quite violent in the last 10 to 20 years, and we have to look at some additional precautions. So stay tuned for more information on that. Tuning into the county commissioners' meetings every Thursday morning at 10 o'clock here on BCTV, or follow us on and any other news media you like to choose. There's been a lot of talk in the last couple of years, and we had an evaluation done about 4 years ago of our jail. Our jail is basically a combination of a 1933 era jail, when the average population was about 150 inmates, bed space for about 250 inmates, and in 1993 an addition was added, so our total bed capacity, double bunking each cell, is about 1,500. Our average daily population now in 2018 is about 1,100 inmates. So we are relatively full. We try not to double bunk people as much as we can, because certainly that creates problems with people who can't seem to get along with each other. But we are looking at primarily the 1933 portion of jail. To renovate and rehabilitate that building would cost more than if we would build a new section of the jail. what I've kind of been looking at and struggling with is the 1993 portion has some issues, but it's not a structural issue as much as it is in today's place. We have a lot more folks with mental health disorders. We have a lot more people with medical issues. So when that portion of the jail was built in 1993, we didn't make enough accommodation for folks with mental health issues and with medical issues. So if we move to either replace the 1993 and the 1993, we need to make more space. Not so much cell space, but space for programming, treatment, for medical assistance and things like that. So what's going to shock you as viewers and taxpayers is the cost to build a new jail. No matter how you slice it, each inmate on average per inmate is about $100,000. That includes the cell, that includes, again, cafeteria space, kitchen space, laundry space, mental health space, and medical space. So you're looking at, as I said, 1,100 inmates, anywhere from $120 to $145 million to build a new jail. Contrast that with the services center that was opened in downtown Reading, a 16-story building. In 1993, it was furnished for about $70 million. Complete build, parking garage, 16 stories, with furniture, about $70 million. The general public doesn't really look fondly at jails and prisons, and people generally feel that the people deserve to be there, and some do, and some basically did something first time, maybe second time, and need a second chance. These folks need to be cared for properly, medical, physical. They need to be out of their cells at certain times. So the new jail design is much more square footage to provide these certain amenities. And $120 million to $140 million is a tough pill to swallow. But again, as in many homes and in many businesses, you don't throw good money after bad. At some point, the Board of Commissioners, along with subject matter experts, have to figure out how to replace, at the very least, the 1933 portion of jail, and more importantly, if the 33 and 93 can connect with HVAC, plumbing, electrical, and that sort of thing. So those are things that are being looked at right now. On the subject of the 422 bypass, the West Shore bypass, as locals call it, is functionally obsolete. It was built in the late 90s, early 60s, and those of you who drive that, about 30,000 people a day. It is about 5.3 miles from Wyomissing to Exeter. There's 11 bridges. There are three interchanges. There is a railroad bridge, actually two railroad bridges, and many, many issues that have to be dealt with that in modern transportation needs is obsolete. The plan primarily is to widen the bypass in both directions to three lanes, to change the intersection at Lancaster Avenue and the Bingham Street Bridge, to change the intersection at Penn Street and Penn Avenue, and to look at the Park Road, not the North Wyomissing Boulevard, the newer interchange, to make that potentially somewhere down the road to build a bridge connecting the 6th Ward and that area of the city of Reading to the bypass. I don't know if most of you remember back when St. Joseph's Medical Center was looking for a new location. They were looking to try to build down along the river, and one of their requirements was to have a bridge built for people to easily access the medical center if it was built in that area of the city. That never came to pass, and ultimately St. Joe's Medical Center moved out to Burn Township. So it's about a $650 million low-side build, reconstruction. It's going to take at least 10 to 12 years. Again, there's no funding at this time, but preliminary design is underway. Preliminary drawings are being done. Archaeological evaluations, historical evaluations are being done. You won't see anything done at all until at least 2022. But when it comes to road construction, bridge construction projects, there's always many, many more years of planning and design than the actual construction. I'll share with you that it's not going to ever be completely closed. There'll always be traffic in either direction, maybe down to one lane at night in either direction as it progresses. But you'll see some of the initial work being done on the Penn Street Bridge as people are traversing the Penn Street Bridge. That's a beautiful historical bridge which is being restored. The upriver side has been completed. Now they're working on the downstream side. That should be open completely to traffic by December of 2019. So right now it's still two lanes coming out of Reading, one lane going into Reading. The last 3 months of the project, there would be one lane in either direction. So that is a something planning for the intersection, which will be connecting Reading and West Reading, Penn Avenue, Penn Street. The cloverleafs are going to go away according to the design, and they'll have a divergent diamond intersection, which looks pretty complicated on paper, but basically you'll be doing a lot of crossovers to get in and out of Reading and into West Reading. Some of the junctures you'll be coming up to a stoplight or a green light, and some you just, they'll be through traffic. Lancaster Avenue, Bingaman Street intersection, that will be all right turns. You'll be going, you won't be going down and hitting a traffic light. You basically be going to make right-hand turns and into a traffic signalized intersection. They're going to put in what they call a flyover off of Route 10, further down past the diner, the Queen City restaurant, for people who just want to get on and off the bypass without coming down and going into Reading or into the 18th Ward. It's pretty fascinating. Once you really look at some of the detailed drawings of the bypass and all the opportunities there are there, things that have been built up around it or over it. There's a very tiny cemetery right across from Queen City Restaurant. If you're ever on Route 10, maybe 20 or 30 graves there. That has to be figured out in the plan, as well as the Rack Pedestrian Bridge, which basically carries walkers and bikers across the river in a safe way. The latest plan is for PennDOT to leave that bridge in place for people to be able to walk and bike in and out of Reading and into West Reading and Cumberland Township. Fourth item is the Census 2020. Even though it's 2018, it's very important that we've pulled together a Census 2020 committee. The county has done that in 2000 and 2010, again in 2020. It's a real collaborative effort of the planning department, the commissioners, the city of Reading, the chamber, the foundations, the community groups, whether it's the NAACP, the Latino organizations, the Reading School District, Berks County Intermediate Unit. The critical thing here is everyone needs to be counted. So there's a big educational component coming up, starting early next year, all through 2019. And then in the winter of 2020, because the cards get mailed in April. They call it Census Day in April, where you will get a card in the mail, fill it out, complete it, send it back. None of that information can be used by anybody by constitutional law other than the Census Department for statistical data. People are fearful of filling the card out. We want to assure people that there's no fear in filling out this card. The very important thing here is that there are 130-some federal programs that are funded based on your population. So think about it. There are things like food stamps, Medicare, Medicaid, SNAP program on down the line, that and community development block grant money is a huge one for the county and the city. Each person who is counted accounts for $2,000 a year times 10 every year, you know, so $2,000 a person, 1 year for every 10 years. It's a lot of money coming into the community, and we want to count everyone. It's not just about the money, it's about being counted so we can do demographic profiles, understand population trends and things like that, so we can plan for the future. If we have an increase in population, we have a stabilizing of population or a decrease in population, trying to figure out the hows and whys. Helps with planning economic development, helps with planning housing and things like that. So our outreach is going to be to the community that you should not fear the census card, fill it out, send it back. Even those folks who are not citizens of the United States should be counted because they count into the census again for all of the federal money that will come into the community. So again, it's very important. We're going to be talking about this. We'll probably do a program just on Census 2020. We're pulling together a budget. We met with several people in the community already. We think the budget will be about $100,000. And the key component of that is to hire some part-time staff to encourage people, to educate people, to get out into community groups, Rotary Clubs, Lions Clubs, again, Latino organizations, the NAACP, and organizations that to encourage their members and folks that frequent these organizations to please fill out the census card and send it back. Last and the biggest issue I have, or the subject I have, is the Opioids Coalition, of which I'm a co-chair, along with Stan Papadimitriou, Executive Director of the Council on Chemical Abuse. We are going to be into about our third year, the end of this year. We started in December of 2015, and we're really going gangbusters. We have a lot of things that we've been doing, and some of those critical things are we were encouraging and were able to secure the warm handoff at the Reading Health System and Medical Center, where folks that go in for overdose are immediately met with a trained recovery specialist. And as of today, about 73% of those people agree to go to treatment. January this year, St. Joe's Penn State agreed to an on-call warm handoff. That is going amazingly well. Difference is that St. Joe's does not get nearly as many overdose transports from ambulances and from family members as Reading Health System does, and that's going amazingly well. I think I mentioned this in an earlier program. Overdoses happen in a lot of places in our community, but more importantly at bathrooms in Wawa's, Turkey Hills, Sheetz's. But the number one location is the BARTA Transportation Center on Franklin Street, where the buses come and go. It's a very, very large block-long building, a lot of places for people to hide. So we actually embarked on a program, a collaborative effort with COCA, with BARTA, and with Security Guards International. They have been trained to administer Narcan. So BARTA was able to provide some money for their days they were not working so they can come in and work and pay their wages or pay them overtime to train the Security Guards International folks through COCA to be able to identify someone who is overdosed and administer Narcan. Narcan's not the be-all, end-all. It's not a panacea. But the goal here for the Opioids Coalition is to keep people alive so they can get into treatment and then ultimately into recovery. Not everyone goes, but there's a lot of success stories out there, and we believe every life is an important life. So I want to tell you a little bit about Blue Cares. Blue Cares is an initiative of, we can bring this up now, I was a little ahead of myself. Blue Cares is something that we've worked on with the Chiefs Association as well as our District Attorney's Office through Chief Deputy Mike Gumbar and John Adams, our District Attorney. This is really going to be rolled out at the Chiefs meeting in October that we emulated a little bit from Lehigh County, and we've kind of crafted it to Berks County. So we call it Blue Cares. That means Cops Assisting Recovery, Engagement, and Support. You see in the upper right-hand corner is the Stop Overdose, Save Lives anchor that the Opioids Coalition has used in all of our media and our letterhead and whenever we are out dealing with the public and talking to public. This is a logo depicting that we are trying to stop overdoses. We had well over 100 people die of overdoses last year in Berks County. That's 100 too many. Our goal is to get that number down to zero. We're not going to quit till we get down to zero. So Blue Cares is, it's not unusual for law enforcement to respond to overdose incidents for the same individual. We hear a lot of times from police agencies where, I was just out there Saturday. I'm out there Sunday. I was out there in the middle of the week. Yes, this does happen. And it causes police officer fatigue. So as long as an overdose survivor remains in his or her active addiction, the chance for repeated and potentially fatal overdose remains high. So the police are frustrated, and they are reaching out and wanting to know what they can do to stem the tide of overdoses. So what is Blue Cares? It's a collaborative program between Berks County Police Departments and Certified Recovery Specialists. Again, as I mentioned a little earlier, this really is to keep people alive and encourage them to go into treatment. So the purpose of Blue Cares is to encourage the overdose survivor to engage in appropriate addiction treatment, to provide the much needed inspiration and the necessary know-how to facilitate such an admission, to inform family members on how they can help themselves as well as how they can support their loved one, and simply how it works. It's actually getting easier. So Blue Cares is Berks County detectives are notified of a Narcan overdose reversal by Berks County law enforcement. How this works is the county detective's office dispenses the Narcan to the local law enforcement agencies. Once they have an overdose reversal, they've revived somebody, they notify the county detectives, hey, we revived somebody on Spruce Street in this township on Saturday night. That's great. Who was the officer? So Blue Care then makes the referral to COCA within one working day. COCA contacts the home police department within one working day to arrange a home visit. So what this is marrying up a certified recovery specialist with the police department, hopefully the police officer was there at the revival, or someone who is trained in that police department. So they visit the overdose survivor's home to occur within two working days or as soon as possible. Trying to do it within 48 hours, it might drift into 72, but as soon as we can compare schedules, we would do that. The police officer and the certified recovery specialist, the CRS, meet at a prearranged location and travel to the overdose survivor's home together. Police officer and CRS engage the ODS, there's a lot of acronyms, so the certified recovery specialist engages the overdose survivor in a conversation offering help to access substance use treatment and or support services. If the overdose survivor accepts such help, the certified recovery specialist will immediately initiate a referral process for appropriate services. Whether the overdose survivor accepts or refuses a referral for services, substance use disorder related resource literature is offered to the overdose survivor. Resources and services are available are provided to the overdose survivor as well as to the family members. We like to encourage the family members to be there when this visit is being conducted. The home visit should last no longer than 15 minutes. If no one is home, a calling card from the Blue Care team and substance use disorder related literature is left behind. Within one working day, the CRS, Certified Recovery Specialist, will make a follow-up phone call to offer any assistance in seeking services. Again, this may not work the first time, may not work the second time, but we feel as though enough education, enough literature, enough caring and concern for these individuals can make a big difference. And then, of course, the assignments. The police department shall identify a minimum of two police officers who will be available for home visits. What will Council on Chemical Abuse do? Coordinate with the police departments for home visits. Provide certified recovery specialists, the CRS, for home visits. Develop a home visit script and talking points for both police officers and CRSs. I think the first time they do this is the most difficult one. Once you get in the hang of it, it probably becomes relatively easy. They will collect and maintain Blue Care's encounter data and supply all treatment and support services resource material. And of course, people always like to know the benefits. And the benefits are many. Another life-saving community policing opportunity, help prevent repeated overdose and potential death. A powerful intervention encounter to place someone into appropriate addiction treatment. And that really is the bottom line. To keep these folks alive, to encourage them to go into treatment and get them appropriate addiction treatment. So really, this is a community that cares. I can always, of course, say thank you. This is a community that cares. The Opioids Coalition, again, has been together for nearly 3 years. We have about 48 active members of the coalition, started out in numbers above 60, and we have 5 subcommittees. We meet every month. We meet the first Friday of the month, mostly at Alvernia College, from 1 to 3 in the afternoon. We really work on things. We really work effectively together and collaborate. We're doing more and more now. We're getting out in the community. We have our act together. We have a lot of successes, and we're going to be getting out in the public a lot more aggressively in the next few weeks. We actually had our meeting today, discuss our meeting on Friday. And just that quickly, I'm out of time, so I'm going to have to pick up on the Opioids Coalition at our next meeting. Thank you.